It is the drip god, the greatest 19-year-old wrestler in the world, Ronan King. And welcome to SWN.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. We're into season 5. The first episode, of course, was with former Spirit Squad member Mike Mondo. And episode 2, well, you know, it's just only the biggest star in Scotland in modern wrestling. And unfortunately, for the next 45 minutes or so, I'm going to absolutely kiss his arse because I can't believe I finally got him on the show. It is the man from the top end of Stevenson. He is a podcaster, TV star, and he does some of the wrestling as well. It's himself. It's Grado.
How you doing, Billy?
I can't wait for this. It's been a long time coming.
I know I am really bad at getting back to folk. It's what a lot of people say to me. They always say he's so hard to get a hold of, for promoters, to other wrestlers, fans, actors. And I do get embarrassed about it. Wait to have a look at my messages in now, right? Wait till we see. I'm so 243 unread iMessages. What have I got? Wrestling WhatsApp 276. That's actually no bad for me. It was up at 1,000 at one point last year. I had to delete everything. So I don't know. I don't know what it is. I've got sometimes I've got a weird relationship. My phone's and picking it up and answering texts and stuff like that. I don't know. It's just I'm quite bad at it. So, but anyway, that's by the by. I'm here and I'm ready to talk to you, Billy, because you're a big supporter of Scottish wrestling, and all the boys and girls appreciate it, mate. So anything I can do to help you, and I love that European title.
You complimented in the wrestling Daft when I appeared on that, and I was in the background, and of course you got to get a hold of it as well.
Was it in Aberdeen?
It was Halloween hijinks after your match with Ronan.
Beautiful,
that's the best, and I've also got the Undisputed there side of me, which I can't. I never remember left and right in this.
So, are they just replicas, or is one of them like the kind of knockoff ones that you can kind of get made with the block logo and stuff?
No, they're all WWE shop official. Right. So
how long have you had that European belt for?
I've had it I was 18 when I had disposable income. So I was 18 and I'm 32 now. So about 14 years.
So, right. Hold on, what age are you, 32, and you got it when you were 18? So what year would that have been?
2008.
Well, so, what website did you get it for?
eBay, 120 quid.
You only got it for £120?
Yep.
That's amazing. And did you get it second hand, or was it?
Oh, it was second hand. It's not the best, Nick. I mean, if I hadn't got it like signed and that, I probably would have got it like re-leathered at some point. But
the belt itself must be 20 years old. Must be 21 years old. I would say with a scratch logo on that. I mean, I remember when it first came out. I remember at a time, it was only you could get the WCW replicas and you could only get the ECW replicas, and I think you could get the NWA title. But I remember when they announced that they were going to be bringing WWF replica belts out, and it just consumed me. It consumed me so much. I wanted one of these belts, and then a year would go past. No, they're too dear. My mum says they're too dear. Of course, I ended up getting one. 2002 Christmas Day. Wow, the best Christmas present ever. Went up to Scott. I mean, by the way, when I speak to you, you're probably going to hear stories that I've spoke about before.
Absolutely fine.
On Wrestling Daft, but I remember going to Scotsman Models in Glasgow on the 6th. Was it the 6th of December? No, I'm getting mixed up. I think the 6th of December was the WWA pay per view in Glasgow. That's what I'm getting mixed up about. But it was around that time I went up with my mum and we went to Scotsman Models because they were stocking some replica belts, and I remember going into Scotsman Models. The Undisputed belt was brought out, and the guy put it over my shoulder, and I looked at my mum and I was like, please. And she went, no chance. Because I think it was maybe like £240 at the time. She went, no chance. But little did I know that when I turned my back, she winked at the guy and went, keep that back for me. And she went back up to get it. But I never thought I was getting that belt. But honestly, I can still remember the morning when I woke up and got that replica belt. It's a big thing. That's why, I mean, why are we as wrestling fans obsessed with belts? Have you seen some of Conrad's?
I've seen some of the background when he's doing the Jeff Jarrett pod and stuff like that. And of course, his backlog of stuff that he's got. Just
I'd love to go to his house just for a wee perusal and all the shit that he's got lying about.
No, that's nuts. But yeah, same kind of memory. It was well, I was 18 is when I got my first belt, and then of course after I got one, I had to go on eBay and try and get some more. But you know, mine was an 18th birthday present, and it was just my folks. They gave me like a nice wee bracelet with my name on it, and that just in case I got lost probably. And I got some like concert tickets, and I was told just go through to our room. There's a box underneath their bed, so I took it out, and it looked like a guitar case. And I was like, I haven't played guitar in years. I don't know why I'm getting this. Opened the box, and there it was, the case, the WWE case, the with best. The belt. Take it out, and there was the Undisputed belt. And I was like,
Would you say that's the best bit of merchandise you've ever? What was your anything else wrestling wise? Any tickets to somewhere or anything like that?
I mean, possibly like when I was doing my eBaying, I've got like I had 300 videos. Again, they're up in my parents' loft, so I don't have them here. But probably my WrestleMania 19 chairs, pretty high up there. Never went to WrestleMania, but again, I think I got it for 100, like that. It's something ridiculous. It nowadays, if I tried to sell it, it would be way more. But
why?
Fact I was able to kind of snipe it at like £110, and I got a WrestleMania 19 chair.
They're definitely worth a couple of bob, because when I done that, the wrestling con in Liverpool last year, what did they call it again? Something wrestle con?
For the love of wrestling, was it?
For the love of wrestling, that was it. There was a guy who had all the chairs. It was like a one-night stand chair. There was like, oh, it was amazing. And I think they were all gone for like a good couple hundred pound. You need to keep a hold of that, mate.
It's somewhere in this house. It's everything's kind of been put away for baby stuff now.
So, oh, no, I totally get it, mate. I totally get it, mate. There's your recall. This place, this is where I'm doing my podcast, and this was supposed to be just today podcast, and then that snowballed into a week and a, when this is a pub, but I've got a wee beer machine and stuff like that. But right now, it's a creche / grotto for Christmas, man. There's just shit everywhere.
Oh, no, the amount of plastic stuff that comes into your house. We got like just a couple of wee things and that, and then of course, granny and granddad, they went, oh, we've got this, and it's humongous, and it's like plastic, and where is it going to go in my house?
It's 2023, Grandad. No plastics. Come on. Ozone layer.
But it's just the best thing ever. So we will speak about wrestling at some point. But yeah, I want to ask you about, yeah, you're the busiest man in wrestling. Like I said, I've got you for about like less than an hour. So we're going to try and pack in as much as we can. Probably not about wrestling. But you're the busiest man. You do TV, of course. You do Scott Squad and what have you. You do radio. You do podcast and yourself, Wrestling Daft and two shots, a pint and two shots. And you're a dad. So how the hell do you balance all that?
Do you know what? I'd say, like I've always been, but I'd say since 2014, 2015, I've been busy, right? And I really have been nonstop. As I said, when I worked in the fire brigade. I started in the fire brigade in 2009, and then my wrestling kind of kicked off 2012, but then it kind of really blew up 2014-15 when I signed with TNA and I was touring with ICW and getting bookings in Germany and all that. And I mean, I remember, you know, I would have I'd work 4 days in the fire brigade, 2 day shifts, 2 night shifts. Sometimes the 2 day shifts, after the 2 day shifts, I'd maybe do a wrestling show at night if it landed on a weekend. And then sometimes I found myself finishing a night shift, going straight to the airport, flying to Florida, then TNA, a couple of days of TNA, then flying back, landing in Glasgow airport at 5 a.m, falling asleep in one of the re-chairs, and then going straight to the day shift again, then to go and wrestle at night, come back, came a day shift. I mean, it just went on and on and on and on, and I loved it. And I honestly just loved everything about getting up early and not getting any sleep and then this and then that. But then obviously COVID happened and it all sort of calmed down. But during COVID, it's like I became a dad and stuff like that. And now I don't have the enjoyment that I did. But well, first of all, I'm not wrestling as much as you know. I mean, I had about 4 or 5 matches last year, but it's been difficult. My schedule has been really difficult since July because I've been doing 2 doors down. So with 2 doors down, I've been doing radio in the morning, going straight to 2 doors down, pre-recording wee bits of radio at night. So, you know, I'm leaving the house at like 5 a.m. and I'm getting back don't get me wrong, they put you up in wee digs in Glasgow, but you know, I've been getting in the summer I was doing that and then I'll get into my bed at 10 o'clock at night, or at least getting home at 10 o'clock, and then I'm wide awake and I end up getting Just Eats and deliveries and blah 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 blah. So I done that for a couple of months, and then I started filming for the BBC for doing a programme that's coming out soon called Scotland's Greatest Escape, which basically saw me in every part of Scotland for the best part of 9 or 10 weeks. So again, I was doing radio in the morning, 5 o'clock in the morning, radio up out there for 6, I'd go radio, finishing at 10, and then driving to Aberdeen, driving to Dundee, driving to wherever, coming back at night, doing radio. Done that for, as I say, that many weeks, and then into pantomime again, doing radio rehearsals, 2 weeks of that, and then into pantomime, and then in the middle of that, try to fit in doing wrestling Daft and a pint and two shots and everything else. There's other wee kind of acting bits and bobs that have popped up for me. So my time that I have in the house is, I don't really have enough yet. Mm-hmm. It's been hard, man. As I say, just because I've got Perry and I've got my stepdaughter as well, and I've got my missus, and we're getting married this year as well, and it's just been really, really difficult. But at the end of the day, man, you need to do it. You really, really need to do it, because you need to strike well. I mean, I might not have these opportunities that I'm getting right now in 3, 4, 5 years time, so I've just got to keep working and working and working. Mm-hmm. I don't stop, baby.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean I'm just doing this podcast. That's my outside of work activities. But I work 9 to 5, and then I try to get as much time with Jack, and then if I can fit in a recording, I will try my damnedest too. But before, I was like doing 5 recordings a week, and that would be I would try to put them out as soon as possible. Now I'm like, nah, once a fortnight, that'll do. I'll try and get someone if I can, and then it's become less of a priority now because I've got something to.
No, you're right. It's like, you're right. I mean, as well as, don't get me wrong, doing a panel and reading and stuff like that, I mean, I've had opportunities to wrestle during that, and just because, hey, Perry, my daughter, you can yourself, I just need to spend more time with her. Mm-hmm. And I don't have, I would feel bad on my missus leaving to go and wrestle. Mm-hmm. It's difficult, man. It's just, my life has completely changed. So it has, but I mean, I did miss it. I was at the pantomime on Sunday, and I got a FaceTime for the tapings in Atlanta, I think. Yeah, Impact were in Atlanta the weekend, were they? Center stage. Hard to kill. Here we go. I'm going to rift. Apologies. That's terrible. It's ridiculous and absurd. And I'm talking about Eddie Edwards and Moose, Joe Hendry, and a guy called Eric Tompkins, who is a producer at TNA. And I was just sitting and I was talking away to them. And then I hung up. And then Stephen Purden shouts at Bob, who I share a dressing room with, at the panel, turned around and went, "You wanted to start greeting, didn't you?" And I was like, "I fucking did." He's like, "You missed that, didn't you?" I was like, "I really, really miss all that. I really, really miss. I miss wrestling earlier. But I've got great memories."
Mm-hmm. I mean, absolutely. Because I, you were just getting into TNA when it was all like a challenge and that. So I was trying to catch it when I can. I was back living in my flat on my own, so it was Freeview. And if I was lucky, I'd catch Impact or catch TNA, where it's called at that point.
That being on Freeview, I mean, that is probably one of the big reasons why they got big crowds. I mean, I remember doing the tour. We'd done it, the first tour that I'd done in 2015, and that was, we had Kurt and everybody else. But 2016, there wasn't as many names, but they still drew in Manchester, Birmingham and Wembley. And it was because of Challenge TV, because it was the only wrestling you could get, and it was in free telly. And I think that was a big part of how popular TNA was in this country at the time.
That's it. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I don't watch AEW, so I can't say if it's replicated, if they did a show now, if it would be the kind of same thing, well, I suppose.
Do you know what I think they would? Because of the ITV gig that they have. Mm-hmm. Again, I was at the pantomime one of the days at the weekend, and we have a, what's her name? What would you say? She's just a theatre goer, right? She's a mega, mega punter for going to watch pantomimes and stuff like that. Cafe is her name. She's in her 70s. She's always front row. And she was at the stage door and she was like, "I love wrestling now." I was like, "You're joking, Cafe." I was like, "What do you watch?" She was like, "AEW." I was like, "You're joking." She says, "I watch it so many hours a week." I was like, "Who's your favourite?" "John Moxley. I love John Moxley." And it was blowing my mind to hear 70-year-old Cafe, who I've known for the last 6, 7 years through Dane Panto, telling me about John Moxley, and there was somebody else that she liked as well. And I thought, I can't believe Sammy Guevara or something like that, you know what I mean? I'm going, that's mad to think, you know, these people that don't have Sky, but they've got their ITV and stuff like that, they're getting the chance to watch AEW. So I've got a good, I think they would draw. I think there would be a big appeal to people in the UK if AEW come here. By the way, have they confirmed it yet?
I've no idea.
Do you watch AEW?
I've tried, but it seems to be every time I watch it, there's always some sort of like really petty dig. And I'm like, you look small time doing it. I'm like, I'm not invested if you're just going to spend that time just like, there's better ways to do it. TNA did it, but TNA did it in such an absurd way that it was funny. I was the one where they were backstage and it was R-Truth and Ron Killens at the time and Abyss. They had balloons. Shane Douglas came with balloons and it was because I think they were in Orlando and WWE had a pay-per-view that same weekend or something. And it was just so hilarious. It was BG James and Killings with their Mahi Mahi backstage. It was like 2005, maybe something like that.
Was that something to do with it? Am I getting this mixed up? But was there no something about WWE were recording an advert for the Royal Rumble?
That was
the same thing? And then they kind of... They tried to, I don't know, did they try and gate crash it or something like that?
That was it, yeah.
Something like that.
Rey Mysterio was, they had to blur his face and Rey Mysterio was there. It was Royal Rumble 2005 advert when they did the whole West Side Story.
I remember that. No, but back to what you're saying about, they don't need to, that's just, you're right, it's small time because the WWE don't really acknowledge them, do they? I mean, I like watching AEW, I like watching the pay-per-views. I really do. Some of the matches are not up my street, but I mean, I see, if I'm being honest with you, I hardly catch any wrestling. I couldn't tell you who's the champion, then, okay? I couldn't tell you much. I mean, see, when I come on Wrestling Daft, I look at the what we're going to be talking about, and I go, I have no idea who these folk are. It's quite embarrassing. It really is. The only stuff I keep in touch with wrestling right now is I look at the podcasts. I love listening to Big Kevin Nash. Mm-hmm. Listen to his podcast.
Not enough time in the day.
No, well, that's
it. Now.
See, well, this is the thing because I mean, I got my motor in April 2021, so not even 2 years, and I've done 46,000 miles in my motor in 2 years, and I mean, and a lot has been done in the last 6 months, but because I'm driving up and down Gonel, Scotland, I'm getting all I do is listen to podcasts, so. I keep in touch with the Kevin Nash podcast. I like listening to Conan and Disco Inferno. They're quite controversial. On Twitter, you go online and he gets a lot of heat. Disco, but I don't know. I find it funny listening to them. But that's the only really wrestling that I kind of keep in touch with is listening to it in podcast. I can't remember the last show that I watched or even old stuff as well. Because I don't have the network. The network is no longer in my telly that I have in my bed at night. So I'd be interested to see that.
That's the thing. When we got, I mean, my PS4 is now just a very expensive WWE network machine.
Streaming thing, aye. That's that, innit?
Nothing else. But no, I just watched WWE because it's just most convenient. £10 a month.
Yep.
And I get to watch a pay-per-view. And with himself as well, he gets up early. So I'll just go down with him. It's, 6 o'clock and just watch. Where pay-per-view was the night before and just catch up and not inflict it on my wife.
that's something for you to do, isn't it? When you wake up with a wee man in the morning and just stick with a bit of the old wrestling. It's not the worst thing for them to be watching, is it?
I'm educating them. It's January. It's Royal Rumble season. So
that's that.
Rumble every day.
That's that. Are you going to be watching the Rumble?
I probably won't watch it live. It depends.
You can't watch it live, mate. You don't have...
Well, I'm at WrestleZone. On the 29th.
They got a show on the Saturday?
They've got a show on the Saturday, so I'll come back, because I live in Elgin, so it's about hour and a half.
Oh, you stay in Elgin?
So hour and a half.
How far is Elgin for Aberdeen?
But it's weird, it's like bang in the middle between Inverness and Aberdeen, but it takes an hour to get to Inverness, it takes an hour and a half to get to Aberdeen.
God, you know, that was one thing that I really messed up, because I kind of thought, this was years ago, that Inverness was pretty close to Aberdeen, I remember. We done a show, I'm sure, and it was a day show in Inverness and a night show in Aberdeen. And I remember doing that drive with Sanjay Dutt and Jay Lethal.
I went to both those shows.
Was it the same day? Am I right?
It was the day after. It was
right
because it was Rock and Wrestle on the Friday, and then it was WrestleZone on. It was their Rumble, their Regal Rumble on the Saturday. I went to both of them.
I tell you what, mate, Steve put on really really good shows and. I'm always talking about how much I love going up to WrestleZone. I love the WrestleZone shows. I love it because the fans up there, I look at them, they follow what's happening, they follow the wee storylines that they've got. They're loud. I've always loved going to Aberdeen. The only fucking issue I've got with wrestling for fucking WrestleZone is four times I've been caught speeding on that certain road between Dundee and Aberdeen, and I actually took my father to the Aberdeen show the last time just to say to him, "Dad, you keep an eye out for this 50 speed limit." And he went, "Right." He says, "You can't do this again." And we went up there and we watched everything we were doing, come back down through the night. Week later, letter through the door, caught speeding, something like 55 or 56 or 57 on a 50. So that's the only issue that I've got with WrestleZone, because it ends up affecting my insurance for my motor as well. Oh, every year, because of WrestleZone booking, because I'm having to put more points on it.
Just putting your fee up every year just to cover it.
That's what I'm going to have today. I'm just going to have to put my fine in, because I know I'm going to end up getting it. It's absurd.
I know. I mean, my shoot job is insurance, so I know exactly how that feels.
Is it really?
it's not exciting.
for car insurance, for house insurance?
A bit of everything. Car, house, bike. But I'm in like in the commercial side now, so I do businesses. And
do you work for home?
I do. This is my office.
Wow, man.
I know, it's great. I've worked home since March 2020, since the pandemic started.
But do you still get pals and all that? Are you still getting stimulated by speaking to people?
I'll be honest, I don't like speaking to people most of the
time.
You
don't?
Anyway,
I get that.
This is what I like doing. I like doing this because after we're finished, there's no awkwardness of us going, like, seeing each other again, passing by. We'll just finish the chat and that's it done.
And we don't need to go in for that like awkward handshake or is it a cuddle and you know what I mean? No, I'm with you, mate. I'm a lot of people surprise us, but I'm really quite socially awkward. I don't know what it is. I have this thing where when I see folk that I've not seen in a while, I start blethering and saying things that I probably shouldn't say and admitting stuff. And do you know what I'm bad at as well? I'm bad when people tell me bad news about themselves. And then I start wanting to laugh.
Yeah. Yeah.
I have this awkward thing where I go, "How are you? How's everything? I know, too bad." And then they might turn around and say, "I lost my husband at Christmas." And I have this, and it's the worst thing ever where I get that. I have this nervous thing where I want to bust out laughing. It's terrible. It is terrible. How's your gran? Oh, she passed. I'm not laughing at it. It's just the awkwardness and the nervousness that I have. I hate it, and I'm sure other people have as well.
Oh yeah, I'm like I don't know how to deal with that kind of news. I'll make you laugh to make it feel better. I'll tell you a joke. I'll
Aye,
do funny, and it never works. But God loves a trier. I'll keep doing it.
I mean, but don't get me wrong. But I think that sometimes helps. Like my mate is what's in the Merchant Navy. And he said that he found an older man had passed away on the boat a couple of months ago. He told me this. And he was saying, you know, it was sad because the guy was just about to retire and stuff like that. And I kind of went, "I can't believe you killed that old man. You've been watching too much Martin Compson." Something like that. Something pathetic. And I thought I'd try and make up, but he didn't really find it funny. But I thought, I don't know, it's quite, I like to kind of, come on. I don't
know. It's like, I mean, I'm the opinion of right, it's bad now. This is the worst it's going to be. So, you know, you be as well just kind of just get on with it kind of thing, which is probably a blessing and a curse. So I can stuff all my bad feelings back, but it doesn't help for everyone else. You just go.
Do you go out for your messages?
Oh yeah, I go my outdoor time, which is like I'm in prison. Outdoor time is like. Go to the shops, go to the wrestling. That's a bit. That's all I do now. It's great.
What does your missus do?
Well, she's at home at the moment because maternity leave. So, that's why she's a stay at home mum until she works at the council. Otherwise, so it's not that far away. So she'll be back in the office by April.
Does she like wrestling?
She likes going to the wrestling.
Have I met her?
You have. We got a you got a picture with her.
I think I didn't remember that. Was it last show though? Was it?
No, no, she hasn't been to the show since Regal Rumble last year. So that was March, because you know pregnancy and traveling.
No, I get that.
But yeah, she's met you. She was one of the Aberdeen Anarchies. She had a 50 Shades of Grado t-shirt on.
Oh wow! Man, I remember when I was over and I sold loads of t-shirts. That was a great period in my life.
I've got a few. I think I've got like four Grado t-shirts, and I'm not wearing any of them.
I mean, do you know what? Here's a story for you. I should have merch because the pantomime that I just done, and I need a hold of cagematch.de. You know that website I'm talking about?
Oh, yeah, it's my Bible.
Right. I need a hold of them because I went over Jack Chester 66 times between December the 3rd and January the 15th. We'd done a bit. I mean, the director just basically took advantage of having two wrestlers on the show, and then we done a bit at the end where they had pantomime got like in a big massive inflatable wrestling ring made. I mean, don't get me wrong, if like Cornette or MD Lat saw it, they would be, you know, spinning in their grave if they were dead. But do you know what, the Waynes absolutely loved it. The Waynes loved it every night we were in. We've done like a kind of 2 minute match, and by the way, I was blowing out my arse every single night. You would never, who knew that? What the Jester says, who knew a 2.5-3 minute wrestling match in a inflatable ring could be so tiring and quite dangerous sometimes as well, because I messed my back up over Christmas taking one of the bumps onto the bouncy castle. So, but what was I going to say? So. Like, I've been getting loads of messages and asking, can I get Grado merch and stuff like that, but I've just not had the time to get merch. I really, really should get back on it. I really only have it for my Family Bash stuff that I did at the Pavilion. Have you been to one of the shows?
I haven't, no. I
you
mean,
need to get to one of these shows,
mate.
I am telling you the new. And I'm not just saying this, but all the boys say it as well. It's the best wrestling entertainment in the world. I'm telling you, the way we do it, with the lights, with the stage, with the music that we have, the wee things that we Daft think, gimmicks that we put on the matches, like we had, you've probably heard me talking about the Wrestling Daft podcast, but we had Max Dead versus Luke King Sharp, who is a scruffy wee guy. Before he gets haircut, he looked as if he needed a wash. He won't mind me saying this. Against Dallas was managing Max Dead, and whoever was beat had to get a bath. What did we call it again?
I carry the results because Wesley sent me.
It was, I know, I'm totally making an ass of this story. It was Adam Max Dead versus Luke King Sharp. If Adam Max Dead wins, Luke King Sharp gets. No, oh, I'm making an ass of this.
Right, I'll see what great.
It was bath or bath versus body match.
That was it, body versus bath match.
Body versus bath match. If Luke King Sharp wins, then Adam Maxted had to take a year off the gym. If Maxted wins, Luke King Sharp had to get the bath. Anyway, Maxted wins and Luke King Sharp goes to get thrown in the bath. Luke King Sharp switches to Reno and Dallas. He takes the bump. Maxted ends up getting in the bath. Toll comes out in a robe and a shower cap, mate. It was just amazing. We had what do you call him? The Pitbull. Pitbull for the pitbulls.
Aye.
Mate, we had a gimmick where he was distracted with a big fucking, I mean, this is Daphne just going on about a big juicy steak and stuff. Mate, I'm telling you, from start to finish, and the women's match was incredible as well. I love the NA shows, they're amazing because the whole crowd are just into it from start to finish, and I mean right into it.
Check, aye, that's a bulk from the famed post show ITV Celebrity Wrestling bulk.
That's right, he did that, didn't he? I need to get him on my podcast to talk about that.
Oh, I've been...
Was that the setup with D'Lo Brown and all that?
It was, yeah. I did a 30-minute, because last year I was like, I wasn't doing many recordings at the back end of the year, so I did a 30-minute like documentary on ITV Celebrity Wrestling just for my own amusement, and I put it out there. And I was trying to get folk on, and like, it just wasn't happening. I had a Victoria Silverstead, I DM'd her, and we traded DMs back and forth, saying, oh, come on. Never happened.
Was there even any wrestling on it?
No, it was all like gladiators. That was
bullshit, wasn't it?
It was the best worst thing I've ever seen, and I was so fascinated by
Who was in that game? D'Lo Brown was there, and who else was there?
Joe Legend. Was the other one. Roddy Piper was hosting with Kate Thornton.
You're joking. Did Piper host it?
Yeah, Piper hosted it. He did the little eye dance in the middle when he was explaining the games and stuff like that. It was mental. And
is it on YouTube?
There's no full episodes on YouTube.
Wow.
The only all the footage I could find is in that 30-minute thing I made, because it was so hard to find stuff.
Wow. And D'Lo, would D'Lo talk to you about it?
No, D'Lo didn't reply. Joe Legend did after I put it out, and I emailed him and he hasn't replied either. So but nobody wants to talk about it. It's fascinating. I love it.
I might talk about this in my podcast as well. I totally forgot about that.
Well, I'll send you the link to mine, and I'll have some information for you.
Please do send it to me.
I will do. So, like I say, we're not going to speak about wrestling, I don't think. But
sorry, mate. I get in a tangent, man.
I love it. That's the point. Nobody's going to listen to this for me telling stories about wrestling and that. They want to hear Grado and Grado off on tangents. So that's all cool with me. So before then, we go off onto our tangents. We ask two questions to everyone on this podcast. I mean, everyone. So from Big Demo, I've had him on. I've asked this. Joe Henry, I've had him on. Rory McAllister, he's been on the show, and I've asked these stupid questions. So you're going to have to do it as well. So first question we ask everyone, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Oh my God, my favorite dinosaur. What's the one would you call the one that's a vegan?
Oh, I don't know. I will Google. You think by this point I would know.
What was the words again? There's carnivore and carna.
Omnivore is both. Carnivore. Herbivore.
Herbivore. I would say... right. What about you know what I'm going to go for? My favourite one is the one... I don't have the name yet. But the one in Jurassic Park where the big fat fella with the glasses is in the Jeep and he turns around and this thing goes...
That's gonna annoy
me. He's in the Tajiri Mist, right to the big fat guy's coupon.
Right, I'm gonna sure miss.
Jurassic Park, scene in car. Let's see. Oh my God, can you believe I don't have Google's a search engine right now? How annoying is that? Why does that do that? And it ends up
what using. What have you got? Bing.
What is it? It's. What the fuck is this? It's Yahoo? The hell, man, what is this? 1998?
Just load up AOL and
by the way, AOL was a big part of me actually getting involved in wrestling. I have nothing near bad words to deal with AOL, the amount of wrestlers that I used to pest their own there back in the day.
Dilophosaurus?
What's it called?
I want to say Dilophosaurus, but it's Dilophosaurus. I don't know if that's an F. Dilophosaurus. There's folk that are listening to this going, I'm just shouting the name of it, but it's a poison spitting dinosaur in Jurassic Park. So that looks
hold on, I want to go to the images here for this. Dilophosaurus. Aye, that's him. That's the guy.
Excellent.
Let's go for him. Because I bet you, does everybody else just say Tyrannosaurus Rex?
T-Rex is the most common answer. Some go for like Stegosaurus and that. Some go a bit wild, Harmony Sky, who wrestled at FPWA, she went for Turkey Dinosaur, and it's still my favorite answer.
That's funny, that's a good answer.
That's an excellent answer.
That's a great answer.
Some have gone a bit away from it, but, you know, it's an open question.
Do you know what? I like learning about dinosaurs. It's one of the ones you can find yourself in a YouTube wormhole.
Mm-hmm.
I like looking up things and finding where bones are and who's actually got a real dinosaur thing and like the bones and stuff like that. I wonder if I've actually seen a real dinosaur statue before. Is there anywhere in the UK that's got one?
Back on the Google to find out. Dinosaurs. I remember seeing one like a natural history museum wherever it is in York. There was a big one because when I went down, I was really young and it was walking with dinosaurs was the big thing.
And I remember that.
They had this humongous dinosaur statue.
Do you know what? I knew I'd seen it recently. London's Natural History Museum. The BBC had 100 years celebration and they had it in the London History Museum and there was a dinosaur thing there. So I've saw it.
Cool. So that's fine. Next question.
That's when I was getting mad with Mary Berry and Lenny Henry was there, Graham Norton was there, Zoe Ball was there. Who else was Jermaine Jenis was there, Sheridan Smith was there. It was like one of the ones where like it's a bit like in wrestling, you know, when you're backstage your roses, don't be taking pictures with the imports, don't take pictures with the wrestlers. And I never ever listened to that rule. I was always like, who gives a fuck with the rules? And eventually, I was the only one at the BBC hang going about taking pictures with everybody. I was marking it for so many legends, past and present, that were in the same room as me. One of the best nights of my life.
That's it. I mean, I don't understand. Like, I understand maybe like the respect thing, shaking hands, all that kind of stuff. You know, cool. I don't understand the not getting to take pictures, because as you say on Wrestling Daft, wrestling's kid on.
I know you're right, but I mean, me and Jessica were talking about this. Remember when Vader was here? There was a guy who wasn't giving you a picture. I mean, I've got this great picture of Vader because I always thought, you know what? I always had in the back of my mind with some of these wrestlers, right? That, you know what? They're in my country, right? And if I act like an asshole and they do me in, it's fine. They do me in. That's, you know, if I get a doing off somebody, that's fine. It's like, what a good story. And I always kind of heard that. That's why I remember when I remember tagging with Vader at East Kilbride. And I remember going backstage and high-fiving him, and he was kind of no-sure. He was like, who is this guy? And I picked up his mask. He was like, what's he doing? And I'm like, can I wear this tonight when I'm tagging with you? And he went, what? Can I wear this? And he went, sure. And I put it on. And you might see, I mean, this thing was hanging off me because Vader's head so big. And somebody took a fly picture, and it's me with a mask on, and Vader sitting in the background. He looks like my dad or something like that, as if he's looking at his son. But the point of the story is, the amount of times that I saw people that weekend when Vader was here, and being nervous. There was Neil the wee man. Wee man Brad. I remember him going, I really want to get a picture of him. I really want to get a picture of him. And it was literally like, when you go, do it, and watching the slow walk up to him while he's sitting there, where he's, Vader's sitting there on his chair in the scud, practically his boss out in a towel. And you could just see like Neil walk up to him, say something, you couldn't hear it, and then instantly Neil walking back. You're like, I take it, didn't work? No. There was another guy as well, I remember Jesse was telling me the weekend, he went up to Vader, and before he got about 2 feet away from Vader, Vader just turned around and went, no! You know what I mean? So there's some of them that just, you know, that don't like it. But I would imagine a lot of the kind of news, I mean, we don't even really get imports anymore, do we?
They often, no.
They're all signed.
Scotty Hotty seems to be the only import at the moment. Of course,
he's the only guy.
But yeah, that's about it. That's it now. But yeah, it's one of those cases that you don't ask, you don't get.
That was one of the only times wrestling with Scotty Hotty when I remember being in a match, because he was babyface, I was babyface. I remember him calling through the match, put some heat on me. I'm going, wow, I'm so out of my comfort zone. Like, it's usually me selling and feeding and whatever, but it was the other way about, and I was blown out my father because I hadn't been used to it at all. But I loved working with Scotty too.
I remember the match. I was front row for that one, 2014.
Were you really?
Yeah.
I'm sure Bill gave me the DVD recently. I need to go back and watch it.
I'll be there. I'll front row with hair. It was I didn't. I shaved it because I've got a picture with Scotty and I've got a too cool t-shirt on.
Well, tell you what, he never had hair either, did he?
He didn't. No, we looked like twins.
Because I always remember Marty Jones being backstage and basically telling him that he'd killed his gimmick because he never had any hair.
Oh, that's...
They won't recognise you. Why did you cut off your hair, your gimmick? They won't recognise you.
There's multiple stories throughout past episodes with likes of Aspen Faith and Dennis Law, referee up in WrestleZone, and they've brought up Marty Jones at 2014 Average Anarchy show, and it gets wilder and wilder every time they get told.
Did they tell you about the one where they were put the guy was basically gone through somebody because he thought they were me? Jamie Keefe, you ever, does that ring a bell? Jamie Keefe, he was a kind of Dundee wrestler.
James Midas. Yep, James Midas.
Yeah, I remember he'll tell you. It's like they were doing like a training seminar during the day, and Marty was basically giving him a bollock and telling him about how he looked stupid in the documentary, and he's taking a piss out of wrestling, and you should be ashamed of yourself and all this. And I think Jamie was like, do you think I'm Grado? He thought Jamie made this with me. So I'm pretty glad that I was late that night and I didn't need to put up with that shit.
Oh, that's amazing. I'm going to clip that to my eventual 3-hour Marty Jones at Avenue Anarchy episode.
Oh, brilliant. Brilliant.
So another question we ask everyone is, again, they're a silly one. I'm noticing the time and I know I've got very limited time left with you.
Sorry, don't worry about it.
It's not you enough to worry about. It's
you.
It's my wife. Another question we ask everyone is, what would win in a fight? So it's, you may have heard this question already from Looking Sharp or Krieger. What would win in a fight, 2 sheep or 1 cow?
For me, a cow surely only needs to take his nose and tip the sheep on its back, and then once the sheep is on its back, it will struggle and then eventually suffocate. So if he has the power to do that twice, go right under its belly, scoop it up with its head, hopefully flip it on its back, then the sheep will succumb to the cow's movements.
Still continues to be my favourite question I ask people.
Has anybody else answered like that? That would be my psychology.
Everyone seems to have, because I'm asking wrestlers, it seems, they all have like a premise and a setup and how it's going to go, how the match is going to go between these three. And it's fascinating because it just shows like kind of thought process. I mean, there is a video on YouTube of a sheep versus a cow and the sheep wins.
How the fuck?
Because the cow runs towards the sheep, but the sheep just stands its ground and just holds its head, and the cow hits the sheep and it just collapses.
Wow.
So it's, I mean, there's no right or wrong answer. It's just a bit, I love that.
Do you get my answer?
Oh yeah. Yeah. Mine's more psychological. It's, you can't, if you take a, it sounds more ridiculous now. I've asked like 100 people this question, but my thought was always, if the sheep can lead the cow up a flight of stairs, cows can go upstairs, but they can't go down because of the way their knees bend. So if they get them up the stairs, it's just a waiting game.
Fuck, that's a good one as well.
I know, it's the question that just keeps on ticking. You'll wake up in the middle of the night and or doing a feed or whatnot.
Do you ask that to everybody?
I've asked it to, I think Looking Sharp's episode was episode, I don't know, 20, and this is 180-ish. So I've asked over 100 people this question, including the names of Rory McAllister, former WWE superstar.
I've milked it.
There's a t-shirt, I've got a T-Mill site, and there's a literal t-shirt with the field, and it's the Shield logo, but with 2 sheep and a cow on it.
That's brilliant.
I've nobody's bought it, but one day. Someone will.
One day, there'll be somebody out there.
Someone desperate enough and really likes cows and sheep. I mean, I can market it to the Northeast or to the Welsh, you know, who knows.
What's not like to be cows and sheep? Sheep are, sheep providers with woolly jumpers and cows, I mean, do you like steak?
Love steak.
I love sheep and cows.
And with that, I think that's a good way to wrap up this episode. So yeah, like I said, it's brief because of our both busy lives, but I'm so happy that I was able to get
mate,
you on.
Mate, did you not put me in a Hall of Fame?
I did, yes.
Why are you not bringing that up instead of fucking asking me about cow and sheep?
Yes, you're part of our
what Hall the of fuck fame. Was that about?
the question or the Hall of Fame? So. Yeah, each year we do our year-end awards, and each year I do a Hall of Fame pick, someone who's just deserves to be in. And this year was weird because a lot of wrestlers kind of walked away. Crusher Crave retired. I don't know if you're aware.
Oh, Big Walter.
And a lot of other wrestlers kind of just stopped doing the wrestling. And I was looking back going, you know what? In there, you've got Drew McIntyre's, or Drew Galloway's inducted, Carmel Jacob, Johnny Lyons, Nikki Storm, who else? I can't remember now.
Fuck's sake, it took you long enough to put me in it.
I know. It took far too long, but no, this year.
What do you get?
What
about one of the fucking 2 sheep and cow t-shirts?
You know what? If that's, I will send you one if you want. And I will.
That could be my, you know what I mean? Instead of the ring, I want one of the t-shirts.
That's it. We'll do it. Send me your size, and I'll if you're not at a show soon, I will send you one.
Send me an XL so that XL. I can fit into it. It can be my gold T-shirt for the summer.
Excellent. I will do that. Two sheep, one cow. Done. So anything you want to plug before we go?
I want to plug my professional wrestling show at the Pavilion Theatre in May. May the 13th, pavilionthatre.co.uk for tickets. I always say to wrestling fans that are, they go to the ICW shows and they go to the other shows and they might think, oh, is this a bit too panel? It is a bit too panel, but it's brilliant and it's great entertainment. If you've got any wee cousins or anybody like that you want to maybe try and break them into wrestling, and this is the kind of show that you want to go to because it's a professional setup. We don't have the wrestlers coming out of fire exit doors. The ring's in decent nick. And the wrestling's brilliant as well. So May the 13th. Also want to plug my radio show if you want to listen to that every morning, weekday morning, 6 until 10, Crofty and Grado, The Breakfast Show, on Go Radio. And my other podcast, Wrestling Daft Podcast, which I need to do an episode of this week because we've been away and I've been whatever. And also A Pint and Two Shots, it's a podcast, it's a football podcast. We can download that or you can watch it on our YouTube channel. In fact, you subscribe to our YouTube channel, Pint and Two Shots. If you like fit by then, it's for you. But even if you like just listening to us talking absolute nonsense, then give that a wee subscribe as well. But Billy, I appreciate you taking on the time. And it wasn't even that long. I actually want to sit and talk to you longer. I'm a bit pissed off that you don't want to talk to me for a bit longer. But I totally get it. And anytime you want to do this again, give me a shout. And if anybody else wants me to do their podcast, I probably want to be able to do it. But take care. And follow me on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. And I don't have TikTok.
Oh, that's fine. It's awful. But perfect, yeah. Thank you very much. We will get you back on again sometime.
You're the man, Billy.
Right, have a good one.
You take care and sending my love to your family, mate, all right?
Thank you.